Welcome to Good News for Life, presented to you by the International Evangelical Church. As we do each week, we bring you a worship experience using a song, our Kids' Corner, and a sermon in our series on 2 Corinthians. Let's begin our worship with this call to worship.
Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of His hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, yet their voice goes out into all the earth. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. This morning, Steadman Harrison will be giving a sermon on reflecting the glory of God. We thought you would enjoy this a cappella medley of songs that sing about the way that God shows His glory. It's performed by one man, David Wesley, and is filled with songs that we still use today. When he holds up the card with a number on it, he is telling you the date that that song was written, and it covers a span of 1,500 years. We'll sing it in about 7 minutes. When you recognize the song, sing along and enjoy this evolution of worship that has taken place over the years as we let our hearts be filled with a medley of praise.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me save that Thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, Thy presence my light. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. And the things of earth will grow strange. Cleansing flood. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread His love to everyone. You want to pass it on. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! We are going to see the King. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. God of wonders beyond a galaxy, you are holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move.
You move the mountains.
And
still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Ruthie, I have a theological question for you today.
Thea, what?
I know it's a big word, but it's something I want to talk to you about.
Sounds boring. Can we talk about it with cookies?
Of course. Cookies help everything. Here you go. Now, do you know what the Holy Spirit is?
The Holy what? Does it come out at Halloween?
No.
Does it live in a haunted house?
No. It lives inside of you and inside of me.
Where? In my tummy? I don't feel anything inside me. Is it moving around in there?
No, it's not moving around at all. It is something that God gives you when you become a child of His.
Why do you talk in riddles? Can you give me another cookie?
Sure, why not? Okay, let's see, let me explain. When you become a child of God, He expects you to live differently.
I know, but that's just not easy. Sometimes I just can't because it's just too hard.
Too hard? Like what?
Like when my brother hits me, I just want to hit him back. Or when mom says, take one cookie, I want to sneak two because I love cookies.
Oh, yes. Those are hard things, really hard things.
So, can I have another cookie?
Sure, why not? Have another one.
What does any of this have to do with that? What did you call it? Holy Spirit?
Okay, the Holy Spirit. Like I was saying, when we become a child of God, He gives us the Holy Spirit to live inside our hearts.
Oh, so He's inside my heart? Mm-hmm. Could I see Him with an X-ray?
No, He's invisible.
Then how do you see Him?
Well, you see Him and other people can see Him too because you live differently.
Ugh! What does that mean? I need another cookie. This is too much brain work.
Sure, have another one.
That's four cookies. I can think better now. Go on.
Okay. God knows that we can't live this life on our own. We can't do it. We just can't. We're not strong enough. So He gives us the Holy Spirit to help us.
Go on. I'm listening.
So when a tough thing comes along, you caught like maybe wanting to steal another cookie, you just ask the Holy Spirit to help you.
You think that will help?
I know it will because it's His job.
I don't understand how that works.
Well, first of all, you just have to remember that He's in your heart, and then you have to remember to ask Him.
But what do I say to Him?
Well, you can start with help.
Just help?
Yes, help me is a really good start.
So what does He do then?
Well, He jumps into action. Sometimes He takes away the temptation, and sometimes He just gives you the strength to resist it, and sometimes
He makes my mom hide all the cookies so I won't eat them all.
Yes, that sometimes He does that too. But you just have to remember that He's in your heart, and you have to remember to ask Him.
I like that. Can I eat my cookies now?
Oh, sure. Here's all your cookies, and I'm going to have one too. We'll eat them together.
Good morning, and welcome to International Evangelical Church. What a great gift it is to actually be in this space this morning. I'm here at International Evangelical Church in Sarbate, and we are looking forward to seeing you again in person. For many weeks, I've been actually recording sermons from a distance, from my home or from Bingham Academy. And it's a great gift to come back into this space and to imagine your faces here very shortly with us. What a gift it will be to actually fellowship together, to worship together. Let me pray for us before we open the Word this morning. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, we thank You and we praise You for the truth of Your Word, for the presentation of Your Word. And we ask right now, as we connect across the divide digitally, that You would wake us up this morning, open our eyes anew, and let us see and be transformed by the truth of what we will read together and understand together. Lord, we pray for International Evangelical Church, that You would grow us in our sense of the body of Christ, that we would know one another and that we would spur each other on in the faith. And we pray for those who are hearing this message today on Facebook and television, Lord, around the world, that You would encourage their hearts. Grow us in Christ today, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. My name is Steadman Harrison, and I've served as an elder here in the past. I've served as a church planter, and it's a great, great gift to be teaching here on and off throughout this season as we look to the future. And I want to open the Bible this morning, and I want to read from a passage that continues in the study from 2 Corinthians. So open your Bible with me if you will, and I believe you'll be able to follow these words on our screen. I want to read one particular verse this morning. I'm going to read it twice. I want you to listen carefully to the words that are here from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. I'm going to read it again. Listen carefully. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. The mighty word of God, the truth of God for us today. Amen. So we come in this passage that we've been studying. We've been listening to the words of Paul as he speaks into the Corinthian church a second time. He's writing again to try and bridge the gap that he perceives may be there. He recognizes that some people have been perhaps led astray by the things that are taking place in Corinth. He wants to draw near to them even by his written word. And so we come to this interesting metaphor this morning, this interesting story, which to me is extremely timely. He talks about a veiled face. You and I have been seeing a lot of veiled faces in recent days. And so let me speak just briefly to this idea of a veiled face. My children went back to Bingham Academy to school this week, and I asked them at the close of their first couple of days, how was the day? Tell me, how was your day? How was it re-engaging with teachers and friends? And they explained that there's many new rules this season, but one of the most difficult things they said was to try and greet their friends and to try and bridge the gap between them and others when everyone was wearing a mask. Even listening carefully to the words of another friend whose voices were somehow muffled because of that mask in front of their face. I asked my wife at the end of the first couple of days, she's the principal, the high school principal, and a teacher, how is it going at Bingham Academy? And she said, oh, it's great to be back, to see parents, to engage with these teachers, and most of all, to be engaged in the lives of these students. But it's a challenging time. She said, I find myself spending so much more energy trying to make sure that the message that I have for them in the classroom, the message in the hallways, and as an administrator is being understood because I get no feedback. Their faces are veiled. Their faces are covered. And so I'm working very hard to find out, are they smiling beneath those face shields and behind those veils? What is it like to actually talk to another person when their face is guarded? This morning, we come to a passage where Paul speaks specifically to the church of Corinth and to our Christian community, and he speaks of an unveiled face. Where does that image come from? So I want to take us back to what I know he's building on. He starts in chapter 3, and he gives us the story of Exodus, chapter 33 and 34. And Paul is taking the people who are listening to his message back to a passage that they know very well. That first interaction that Moses has where we get to peer in and hear the conversation Moses is having with mighty God. What an incredible gift it is for him to bring that back to our minds, even as we study the Word of God today. And so what was taking place in chapter 33? Moses has been striving with this people. God has been displeased because of the things that they have done, like making a golden calf, steering their minds towards images rather than to the true God. He describes them as a stiff-necked people, a disobedient group of people. And Moses is talking to God and pleading with him to guide them, to show them the way, to do it in person. And he asks him, after God promises to be with him by way of his presence, Moses says, please show me your glory. Chapter 33, verse 17 and following, unpack that conversation. And in Exodus chapter 33, we see Moses boldly asking God, show me your glory. And God's reply to him, a few things that stand out. He says to Moses, I'm going to give you what you desire because I know you by name. He mentions the fact that he knows Moses. And he now also says, "And you know me by name, the Lord, Yahweh. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. I will show mercy to whom I will show mercy." And following that, he explains, "Moses, I want to let you see my goodness, but I can't let you see my face." He explains that he will have to hide him in the cleft of a rock and literally put his hand over his head as he passes behind him, showing him his goodness, but never letting him see his face, because no man can see the face of mighty God and live. What an incredible grace it is for Moses to spend this one-to-one time with the divine God himself, Father God, speaking with Moses, knowing him by name and being known by name and having a conversation. If we look just a little bit further in the scriptures, when we come to chapter 34 of Exodus, we see that Moses is coming down off Mount Sinai, and we see the encounter that he has for the very first time with his brother Aaron, with the elders and the leadership of the people, and with all of those who followed him out of Egypt. And it says that when they saw him, he was unaware of the fact that his face was shining, that his countenance was glowing, his skin was literally glowing because he had been in the presence of mighty God. And the people, when they see Moses with this glowing skin and shining face, are scared of him. They're afraid and they actually step away, step back. But Moses invites them into a conversation. He explains what he's been talking about with mighty God, the commandments that are being now shown to those people, and the covenant that's being promised with that people, and the presence of God that is going to rest with them and go with them as they go towards the promised land. What an incredible gift it is that they are able to draw near to Moses and see the reflection of God's glory still shining on his face. But this is where the veil comes in. In chapter 34, verse 29 and following, what we learn is that Moses decided to put a veil over his face after the conversation. And if you look at the scriptures closely, when he goes into tabernacle to actually spend time with God, he takes the veil off again. And then coming out, he shows the people his face again, glowing and bright. And then after a conversation, he replaces the veil. When I first read this passage, even going back to my childhood, I remember that I thought that the veil was in place to keep the people from fearing a conversation with Moses. Can you imagine just seeing someone whose skin was glowing, whose face was radiant and shining because clearly they had been in the presence of God? I would be scared. And so I thought perhaps Moses is being so kind to place that veil there to make certain that the people who are listening to him wouldn't fear and could draw near in his presence. But as you look at the passage closely, he's always taking the veil off when his face is shining. I think it's very clear. What happens is he realizes that the glory of God, that shining face that he has, is diminishing. It's dimming. Like the lights on my face right now, if we were to turn the lights down hour by hour and day by day, as Moses spends more time away from the presence of God, his face is not quite as radiant as it was before. He places the veil on to show that he is sensitive to the fact that his presence and the reflection of that glory is diminishing in terms of its return. He doesn't want the people to see a dull face, a human face that hasn't been lit up by the glory of God. And he puts the veil on until he goes back in, almost like a battery being recharged, so that his face again can shine brightly and he can come out and he can let the people know we are in fact close to mighty God. God is with us. That's the background that Paul brings to bear. That's the message that Paul wants us to understand as he speaks these words to us from, again, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. "And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit." There's 3 points to our message this morning. And if you're taking notes, I just want you to capture these. And the first is this: Paul recognizes that we now, by way of Jesus Christ, have access to the direct glory of God. We have access by Jesus. We're able to fully receive God's glory. What a great gift this is. Moses went with trembling before mighty God. He had to have a conversation and an argument, and it was clear that God had to hide him in the cleft of the rock, could only pass by the backside of Moses. God said that this alone was possible because he knew Moses' name, and Moses knew Yahweh God, the mighty name of God himself. There was a relationship there. And we get a precursor, a glimpse of the relationship that you and I have access to by way of Jesus. Our Lord Jesus Christ came and made a way that you and I can come, yes, still trembling because of the amazing might and awesomeness of God, but with fear and trembling, we can come before him. We can stop and we can pray. We can come together in fellowship and we can see the radiance of mighty God directly because of Jesus Christ. Paul knows this, and he's seeing the fact that he no longer needs to send letters of recommendation. He no longer needs someone to check his credentials as he speaks to the Corinthian church. He says, look around. Recognize the relationship that's being restored between your people in Corinth, between those who travel with me, between me specifically and God himself. We can see that transformation because we get the glint of the ability that we have to receive God's glory. Paul has received it directly. Remember that path on the way to Damascus. Remember the bright light that blinded him at first because his eyes were not meant to see the glory of God yet. He was still stuck in his sin. Jesus reaches out to him and he calls him by name. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And we know the rest of that story. There's a relationship that's built through Jesus to mighty God. And the scales of Paul's eyes fall away, and he's able now to see Jesus, to see God as if face to face. He has this amazing encounter with the Spirit where he's taken up into glory and he's taught all kinds of powerful lessons. And those are the things that he knows precede any speech that he has. When he talks to the people, when he teaches the word of God, when he writes them a letter, he recognizes that the glory of God he has received is something that they can perceive and understand. A couple of weeks ago, as we were talking together, I brought up the passage from Acts chapter 4, and I mentioned that Peter, when he went before these elders and the leaders of the synagogue, they had a conversation, and Peter closes a monologue. And these elders say, aren't these common men? Aren't they people from Galilee? Don't we recognize the voice and the accent of mere fishermen? And yet they speak in a new way. And it was clear to those, even as they listened and watched Peter's countenance, that he had been with Jesus. Friends, we have the ability by way of Christ to receive God's glory. The second point that I want to have very clearly brought across by the word of God today is that by Christ, we are ever more able to reflect God's glory out into the world. The passage this morning that we're reading says that beholding the glory of the Lord, we are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. Because we know Jesus, there is something that is now at work in our lives. We are being remade day by day, transformed clearer and clearer into the pure and perfect image of Jesus. And one day that perfect image is going to be completely and completely forever restored. Right now, we're in that process. God has redeemed us. He's purchased us and he is building us up to make us more and more like the person of Christ each day. And so as we spend time in the Word, as we spend time in fellowship with other brothers and sisters in Christ, as we go forward with the gospel good news, the great gift is this, that you and I reflect more and more purely the image of Jesus and the mighty glory of God out into the world around us. Moses did this when he came down off of Mount Sinai. He had been communing with Father God. And when the people saw him, his skin was glowing, his face was glowing, and they were scared of what they saw because it was something that they had never experienced themselves directly. recognize the humility. Moses didn't realize that he was glowing as he came down off of that mountain. You and I, at our very best, we don't even know how it is that we're reflecting God's glory, that the countenance of God is shining through us. We simply are representing well, mighty God, our love for Jesus Christ, and by way of his Spirit, we're showcasing to the world around us, we are different, and we are more and more different each day by the transforming power of the Spirit of God in us and by the truth of the Word empowering us and making us different day after day. So first point, we're able to receive glory. Second point, we are able to now reflect glory. And finally, we do not do this alone. God has a purpose for his church, and it will be so exciting to see you here face to face representing the body of Christ together as a congregation. It's been hard this last season as we've been pulled apart into small pockets and homes, into workplaces where we don't get to have the same level of fellowship and the degree of time together that we're used to in the past. But what Paul says in this passage is a wonderful reminder. And we all of us with unveiled faces beholding the glory of God are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. This comes from the Spirit who is the Lord God himself. Friends, Paul recognized that when he spoke to the church at Corinth, he did not speak as a solo agent of God. In fact, he had a witness around him, a cloud of witnesses, people who like him have been transformed and were speaking that message alongside of him. He's telling the Corinthian church, look around, see that glory reflected in the transformed lives of people in Corinth. The church is no longer what it used to be. It is becoming more and more like the person of Jesus whom we are striving to follow after, and we're doing it collectively. I once went to a farm outside of Mississippi, and I remember this farm. It was a solar panel farm. I had never seen anything like it. I'm used to seeing maize or corn, fields that were growing with wheat. But in this case, a farmer had decided he was going to do something unique. He was going to take that space that had previously been there for the cropping of beans and all kinds of agricultural purposes, and he was going to change it. And he put out into his farm solar panels, one after the other, lined up in rows. And he turned those things towards the light of the sky. And as the sun came up each morning, you can imagine the bright light on all of that glass. Not only was it soaking in the power of the sun, receiving God's glory, if you would, it was also reflecting it. It was shining back. And for my eyes, it was almost hard to look in the early morning sun. But not only that, it was being charged up and useful. It was powerful and purposeful. It provided energy. It provided electricity to the community around it. You may see a solar farm one of these days, and I want you to remember when you see those solar panels, this idea, this beautiful picture that we have of our unveiled face, no longer ashamed because of a diminishing return, no longer concerned because we are somehow losing our charge, but our ability to receive God's glory, our ability to reflect God's glory more and more purely because we are being transformed by Jesus, transformed by the Spirit, and the purpose that we have in receiving God's glory and shining it out collectively, we all together do that. The church has the power to reflect God's glory in a unique and powerful way. When we bring the gospel and the good together, when we are transformed little by little, what does that transformation look like? Our marriages are different. Our parenting styles are different. When we're together with other people and there's conflict, as we've been talking these past few weeks, our response to conflict is different. We find a source, which is Jesus himself, to be the bridge maker and the peace builder out into our world around us. We stand boldly. We're able to speak like Paul and Peter, who no longer sound like common men, but have been transformed because of their time with Jesus. We are salt and light to the world around us. You and I have the capacity now, and collectively, because we don't stand alone, we can showcase the truth of God's glory out to a world in need. The most important thing that we can showcase, not only have we received God's glory and we reflect it back, but we want people to know our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through Jesus Christ. When you come to International Evangelical Church, our desire is to open the Word of God, to explore the things that Paul points us back to, like Exodus, like that story of Moses, his encounter with Yahweh God, to talk about what was going on in the early church, in Corinth, in places where there were all kinds of divisions and discords and troubles, and to see what men of God like Paul were doing by way of the Spirit to bring peace to those places, only that we might be able to hear in 2020, the year 2013 for those of us celebrating the new year here in Ethiopia, to take that mighty glory of God out into our community. First in our Kabelis, out into the great city of Addis Ababa, across the nation of Ethiopia, and out into a world in need. We pray that that's happening even now. I want to close my message this morning with a blessing that's found in Numbers 6. It's one that should be familiar to our ears. I'm going to state this blessing over you and over your family this morning, and then I want to step back and just speak briefly about the meaning of the blessing in light of what we've just read. So here is the blessing this morning. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. May he be gracious unto you. May he make his countenance be lifted up upon you and give you great peace. This is a blessing from Numbers 6, where we see Moses blessing Aaron, blessing the children who are going to go out bearing the image of mighty God. I want you to receive that blessing this morning. I can only give it because I have received it. Understand, a person who wants to share that blessing can only stand in it and stand for it and transmit it to another person in need of it because they have relationship with the God who grants it. I don't have the power to bless you today, but I know the one who does. He knows me by name. I know Yahweh God by name. I know his son, Jesus Christ, and I know the Holy Spirit, and I desire for you to receive that blessing. Think of Moses giving that blessing. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. Moses knew what it was to beg of God, God, show me your face, show me your glory. And for God to say, no man can see my face and live. I must hide you in the cleft of the rock, put my hand over your head as I pass behind you and show you only a portion of my goodness. Moses wants for those people who come after him to have the restored and perfect relationship that he knows is possible. He wants them to receive the shining face of God directly. And so I bless you this morning, and I ask that by way of Jesus Christ, that the Lord would shine his face upon you, that he would be gracious unto you. Mighty Yahweh God says, I am who I am. I will be gracious unto whom I will be gracious. I will show mercy to those that I will show mercy. That blessing alone pleads with him to show you mercy and to show you grace today, not because of anything that you deserve, but because of the precious blood of Jesus that has been poured out for your life. We would want you to come to this place and to receive the abundant blessing that there is in fellowship with people of Christ. Come and learn more about the way. Come walk with us as we study the Word of God, and we trust him day by day. Let me pray for us in closing. Mighty God, be gracious to us and bless us and make your face to shine upon us, that your ways may be known on the earth, your power of salvation to the very nations around us. Lord, we pray that prayer from the psalm. We pray this blessing over every person hearing the word of God today. Bless us, Lord. Make your face shine upon us. Be gracious unto us. Lift up your countenance upon us. Give us great peace, abiding peace that is possible through Jesus Christ. We pray it in his name. Amen.
Lord. that's right. Just sing out in your own words. Just sing out in your own words.
Thank you for joining us today. If we can be of any help to you spiritually, please feel free to contact us using our email address at iec@iecinadis.org. You can also find us on our website and social media pages. Next week, we are going to continue our series on 2 Corinthians with a sermon from Pastor Nell Motz. We are excited to announce we are finally opening up our church live services. The first service is going to be held on October 4th at 9 a.m. We would appreciate it if you can wear your own masks and bring sanitizers. Even though we don't have children programs running, the children's program are going to continue via Telegram until we give you final details. Now, as we leave you, receive this benediction.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. And all God's people said, Amen.